I'm going to share this morning on prayer, Jesus in prayer. In Luke 5, verse 14, and he ordered him to tell no one. This is after Jesus healed the leper. The guy with leprosy came to Jesus and said to him, "Lord, if you will, you can make me whole." Jesus said, "I will." He healed him, and then he told him to go and do what he was supposed to do at the temple. And in verse 14, he ordered him to tell no one, but go show yourself to the priest and make an offering for your cleansing, just as Moses commanded, as a testimony to them. But the news about him was spreading even further, and large crowds were gathering to hear him and to be healed of their sicknesses. But Jesus himself would off slip away to the wilderness and pray. Isn't that a great verse? Jesus would off slip away to the wilderness and pray. It was very important through you, and I'm not going to look at all the verses that talk about this, but throughout the Gospels it talks about how important prayer is to Jesus, or was to Jesus, that he would, no matter what was going on, he would slip away and take time to pray, to rejuvenate himself, to enjoy his fellowship with his Father, to pray, to just pray. It was important to him. Look at chapter 6, verse 12, for another place where it talks about his praying. 6:12, it was at this time that he went off to the mountain to pray. At this time, this is following the record where he healed the man that had the withered hand, and he was criticized by the religious leaders for doing this on the Sabbath. It was at this time that he went off to the mountain to pray. And he spent the whole night in prayer to God. He spent the whole night in prayer to God. I know some people have a difficult time figuring out how to have 5 minutes of prayer before they go to sleep and 5 minutes of prayer when they wake up. Jesus spent the whole night in prayer. And then the next morning, when it was day came, he called his disciples to him and chose 12 of them, whom he also called apostles. Perhaps it was because he had this major decision to make the next day, this major appointment, that it was necessary for him to pray all night long. It doesn't really say that. I guess I'm assuming that. Either way, he prayed all night long. And then after that, he made this great selection. In chapter 9, just looking at showing you first and foremost how to Jesus prayer was vital. It was important. He who walked perfectly, who always did the will of God, who always spoke the word of God, perhaps the reason he was so successful at doing that as a man was because he was so dependent upon God in prayer. In Luke chapter 9, verse 16, then he took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish. This is where he fed the 5,000 people. And he blessed it and gave it to him. Everybody ate. Verse 17, and they all ate and were satisfied, and the broken pieces which they had left over were picked up, 12 baskets full. And it happened that while he was praying alone, the disciples were with him. And he questioned them, saying, "Who do people say that I am?" Again, I like that verse of Scripture. He was praying alone while the disciples were there with him. Which means that, you know, they're all doing whatever they're doing, and Jesus is praying. And that takes a level of discipline, right, to while everybody else is engaged. And again, now we know that there's 12 of these guys, so they're all, and I can imagine that there was quite a bit of chatter going on. They just fed 5,000 people. They just saw a tremendous miracle. But Jesus was alone in the midst of those people praying. Prayer was that vital and that important to him. Look at Matthew chapter 14. Obviously, the point that the teacher's trying to make here is that prayer is important. It was important for the Lord, and it should be important for us. And sometimes we get tricked into thinking we don't have time in our busy lives to pray. Well, That's got to be a big time deception to think that we don't have time to pray. Because we do find time to, most of us find time to watch a TV show for an hour at night, if not more. Certainly many of us today will have time to watch a 3-hour football game. You know, we have time to do things that we like to do. We have time every day to eat. And, you know, you feel like there's a level of deception that's going on with all of us when we say we don't have enough time to pray. And we're, maybe we just haven't experienced the joy that prayer should bring to us, why do we spend time doing other things that are less important? You know, that's my point. We spend so much time doing other things that we do because we enjoy them. If we're not doing that with prayer, we're being deceived into, we haven't reached the fullness of what it should be and how enjoyable it should be. Can you imagine praying all night long? And first of all, staying up all night long for some of us would be something. For some of us, getting past 9 o'clock is a big deal. So, you know, so for him to have that kind of appetite and that desire for fellowship with God is confronting to us. That makes you think maybe we're missing something, doesn't it? I think, you know, you've probably heard this, the turkeys are kind of dumb. And I kind of feel like a turkey when it comes to prayer. You know, that I'm really not as lit up on this subject as I should be. That if it was this important to Jesus, who was perfect, how much more important should it be for those of us that are imperfect? And we don't want to be dumb as turkeys. You might get run over by an unsuspecting, whatever. You take it the rest of the way. Matthew, what did I tell you? Matthew 21? Oh, Matthew 14. Do we read it? Well, we better. 14:23. Well, verse 22. And immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and to go ahead of him to the other side while he sent the crowd away. After he had sent the crowds away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. And when it was evening, he was there alone. But the boat was already a long distance from land. And you know the story. He comes out and walks on water to help them. But he again, after this, this was another feeding of a multitude. He took the time to be alone in prayer. And to have the passion and the desire and the energy to be with God in prayer. Look at chapter 26 of Matthew. He made provision in his life to pray. In Matthew 26, in verse 36, and Jesus came with them to the place called Gethsemane. And you're all familiar with this record. This is at the end of his life. And he said to his disciples, sit here while I go over there and pray. And he took with him Peter, John, and the two sons of Zebedee, and they began to be grieved and distressed. And he said to them, my soul is deeply grieved to the point of death. Remain here and keep watch with me. And he went a little beyond them and fell on his face and prayed, saying, Father, if it's possible. And you know the prayer that he prayed. He prayed this three times. And when you study this in all of the Gospels, it says that he prayed for an hour. And the indication is that he prayed for 3 hours. He prayed for an hour, he came back out, and then he went back in, and then he went out. Three times he prayed, and then God sent an angel and ministered to him so that he would be prepared to do what God wanted him to do in surrendering his life and enduring the suffering. In other words, he needed God's help, so he prayed to get God's help. He was dependent upon God. He was dependent upon him because of the obvious. He prayed. Isn't prayer, prayer is sort of a manifestation of a humble person. You know, I need your help, is what that says when we pray. We say to God, I really need your help. It's also the manifestation of a person that loves God and wants to spend time with God. and enjoy, because prayer is a lot more than just asking for things that you need in your life or praying for other people. It's also a time to give thanks to God, to praise God, to commune with God. And when we pray, it's saying to God that we trust Him, that we need Him, and that we love Him. These are all good things. In Matthew chapter 7, no, I'll go back to Matthew chapter 21. Matthew 21. Now, in the morning, when he was returning to the city, Matthew 21, 18, he became hungry, Jesus we're talking about, and seeing a lone fig tree by the road, he came to it and found nothing on it except leaves only. And he said to it, "No longer shall there ever be any fruit from you." And at once the fig tree withered. Seeing this, the disciples were amazed and asked, "How did the fig tree wither all at once?" Jesus answered and said to them, "Truly I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what was done to the fig tree, but even if you say to a mountain, to this mountain," they must have been by a mountain, "be taken up and cast into the sea, it will happen. All things you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive." Now, Jesus wasn't one of these kind of guys that just did anything that came to his mind. He always had a purpose for everything that he did. And he cursed the fig tree. I mean, what did the fig tree do to him? The reason for cursing the fig tree, obviously, was for the opportunity to share with them the importance and the power of prayer. He cursed the fig tree. It withered right away. And they say, "Lord..." And then he talked to them about the significance and the power of prayer. "Whatsoever you ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive." I mean, you want to get a point across to people. There's no greater way of doing it than illustrating it. What a great illustration. What a powerful illustration that he gives. He curses a fig tree and then he says to him, "Now you can do the same." There is such great power in prayer. Obviously, you would have to be in alignment with the will of God when you pray. I mean, God isn't going to answer prayer that's contrary to His will. But again, it emphasizes the great significance and the power of prayer in Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. You know, in the many years that I've taught on the subject of prayer, I've yet to have somebody come up to me afterwards and say, "You know, I think I've just been praying too much, and I got to discipline myself to do it less." That's not usually the way it goes. Usually the way it goes is people are feeling guilt and condemnation, and, you know, "We should do more of this, and why am I praying more?" And I, you know, we're all the same, and the reason that we have difficulty with the subject of prayer is because it is so important. And we do have an adversary that hinders us and attacks us and gets us distracted from this. And we've got to fight through that. Prayer is far more important and valuable and needful in our lives than, and we need to resist it and be strong in this. Look at this in Matthew 7, in the Sermon on the Mount, his first teaching. Of course, I love reading this verse, this section of Scripture, because I do it a lot. "Ask and it will be given to you," 7:7. "Ask and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be opened. Or what man is there among you who, when his son asks for a loaf, will he give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, he will give him a snake, will he? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your father, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give that which is good to those who ask Him?" Again, this particular way of speaking is repeated again in chapter 11. We'll look at in a minute of Luke. But it illustrates again two points that if you ask, seek, and knock, God's going to respond. And when He responds, the second thing is, it's going to be good for you. It might not necessarily be what you think, but it will be the best for you. He's not going to give you something to hurt you. He's going to give you the best. The reassurance, again, woven throughout the teaching ministry of Jesus, not only did He pray, but He encouraged us to pray. And He was such a good teacher on the subject of prayer because it was His life experience. It wasn't something that was foreign to Him and teaching something He didn't know anything about. He knew about it greatly, and He knew that this is what God did with Him, that He would do with those of us who did the same. Look at the Gospel of John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John 14. John 14. This is the what I just showed you was His first teaching. This is His last teaching before He's taken captive. In John 14, it's interesting that prayer, again, is part of the subject of the teaching, part of His teaching ministry at the beginning and the end. In John 14, verse 13, "Whatever you ask in My name, that will I do, so the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask Me anything in My name, I will do it." Is that hyperbole? Is He exaggerating? Or does He really mean that? I think He's meaning it. I don't think He exaggerates. I think that He will do what He says He will do. In chapter 15, verse 16. "You did not choose Me, but I chose you and appointed you that you would go and bear fruit, and that your fruit would remain." It doesn't seem to be right. 15:7. "If you abide in Me and My words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you." There's a qualifier there. If you abide in Me and My words abide in you, ask what you wish and it will be done for you. Then chapter 16, verse 23. In that day, the day that He would ascend into heaven, "in that day you will not question Me about anything. Truly, truly, I say to you, if you ask the Father for anything in My name, He will give it to you. Until now you have asked for nothing in My name. Ask and you will receive, so that your joy may be full." He's giving us instruction on how to pray. When we pray to God the Father, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Up until that time, they weren't doing that because if they wanted something, they would just ask Jesus. He was there with them. He's saying, "I'm going away." And of course, He's still away. He's in heaven. And now He says, "You pray to the Father in My name." Verse 25, "These things I have spoken to you in a figurative language. An hour is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figurative language, but will tell you plainly of the Father. In that day you will ask in My name. And I do not say to you that I will request of the Father on your behalf, for the Father Himself loves you, because you have loved Me and have believed that I came forth from the Father." He's saying, you know, "I came forth from the Father and have come into the world, and I am leaving the world and again going to the Father. I'm leaving, I'm going to be with the Father, but you pray to the Father and have a relationship with the God, with the Father through Me." According to Jesus, then, these verses that we looked at, and there's certainly many more to look at, if you turn to Psalms while I'm talking here, Psalm 66. According to Him, the possibility of prayer seems limitless, as long as they are in alignment with the will of God stated in the Scriptures. Obviously, we can't expect for God to respond to prayers that contradict godliness or are deterrent or detrimental to our well-being. In Psalm 66, there's another thing we need to take into consideration in our prayer life if we want our prayers answered. In Psalm 66, verse 16, come here, come and hear all who fear God. And I will tell of what he has done for my soul. I cried to him with my mouth, and he was exalted with my tongue. If I regard wickedness in my heart, the Lord will not hear. But certainly God has heard. He has given heed to the voice of my prayer. Blessed be God, who has not turned away my prayer, nor has his loving kindness for me. There's a qualifier with this prayer thing here. He said, if I regarded wickedness in my heart, the Lord would not hear me. God is not a fool, nor is to be mocked. If we want our prayers answered, we can't be all about wickedness. We have to be about godliness. Look at Proverbs chapter 1. Jesus talked about, he made such absolute statements about God answering our prayers, but it wasn't in contradiction to the other things that are written in the scriptures about prayer. There is this union that we're to maintain with the Father and to live with him. In Proverbs chapter 1, it's talking here in this where we're going to read, where wisdom is the personification of God working with people. God provides wisdom, but it's speaking as if wisdom is talking to you. Verse 120, wisdom shouts in the street. She lifts her voice in the square. And the head of the noisy streets, she cries out. At the entrance of the gates in the city, she utters her sayings. In other words, wisdom is there. Wisdom is available. Wisdom is right, accessible to you. And that's what we need in life, isn't it? We don't know what to do a lot of times. You know, which way do we go and what is the right thing to do? I belonged years ago to a ministry that told me, you know, if you need wisdom from God, you pray, and whatever your first thought is, that's God telling you. Then I went to a meeting many years later, and a meeting with people in addiction, and the person was sharing, and she said that where she was sharing, she said, whatever my first thought is, I know not to do that, because that's always gotten me in trouble. I mean, you can't stick God in a box and say that this is the way that he works. Fact is, we all need wisdom in everything that we do. And if we want God's wisdom, it's available, it's accessible. But you have to seek it in the proper fashion from him. Verse 22 says, how long, O naive ones, will you love being simple-minded? And scoffers delight themselves in scoffing. And fools hate knowledge. Turn to my reproof. Behold, I will pour out my spirit on you. I will make my words known to you. Because I call and you refused, I stretched out my hand and no one paid attention. And you neglected my counsel and did not want my reproof. I will also laugh at your calamity. I will mock when your dread comes. When your dread comes like a storm, your calamity comes like a whirlwind. When distress and anguish come upon you, then they will call on me, but I will not answer. They will seek me diligently, but they will not find me. Because they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of Yahweh. They would not accept my counsel. They spawned at my reproof. So they shall eat of the fruit of their own way and be satiated with their own desires or devices. For the waywardness of the naive will kill them, and the complacency of fools will destroy them. But he who listens to me shall live securely and will be at ease from the dread of evil. We want God to answer our prayers. We can't ignore his counsel. We can't live contrary to his scriptures and expect that he is going to respond to us. You live like hell, you end up in jail, you got no way to turn, and you pray to God and you expect for him to help you, and then you get disappointed that he hasn't helped you, but you've lived a life completely without him. I mean, God is not, he's not a fool. He's not to be mocked. He's not an ATM machine you just, go to and pull something out when you need it. Well, that doesn't work for most of us either if you don't have something behind that, right? You have to have money in the bank. Another verse of scripture that speaks to this is Isaiah 59. Actually, there's quite a few, but I've selected a few of them here this morning. Isaiah 59. Isaiah 59, verse 1. Behold, the Lord's hand is not so short, Isaiah 59, 1, that it cannot save, nor is his ear so dull that he cannot hear. I think of the ever-loving arms of God that are always extended out to anyone who, with a genuine desire, seeks him and doesn't want the things of the world or doesn't want unholiness, but truly wants him. Whoever that person is, no matter what they have done in their life, if they are humble before him and they truly repent, if they seek out to him, the ever-loving arms of God are there to embrace them. And his ears are open to those who truly repent and need the help of God. But to the arrogant and to those that have a lifestyle of ungodliness and don't want God in their life, it's sheer foolishness for them to think that this God is going to respond and all of a sudden answer their prayers because they've run themselves over again. They've been turkeys. Verse 2, but your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God. And your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear. For your hands are defiled with the blood, and your fingers with iniquity, and your lips have spoken falsehood, and your tongues mutters wickedness. No one sues righteously, and no one pleads honestly. The just in confusion and speak lies, and they conceive mischief and bring forth iniquity. They hatch adder's eggs and weave the spider's web. He who eats of their eggs dies, and from that which is crushed a snake breaks forth. Their web will not become clothing, nor will they cover themselves with their works. Their works are the works of iniquity, and the act of violence is in their hands. Their feet run to evil, and they hasten to shed innocent blood. Their thoughts are the thoughts of iniquity. Devastation and destruction are in their highways. They do not know the way of peace. There is no justice in their tracks. They have made their paths crooked. Whoever treads on them does not know peace. Again, there's this balance, where there's a genuineness and a sincere godliness about us, where God is not just someone to, he's not a Baal's bondsman to get us out of our trouble. He's not our enabler, that when we get ourselves caught in our addictions and our problems, that he comes along and helps us. It doesn't work that way. You don't play God. He's not like a lot of people that you can play. God is real. And there's a genuineness about ourselves and our desire to live a godly life that is required if we want him to answer our prayers. Again, Jesus illustrated in such emphatic, dramatic, powerful ways the willingness of God to answer prayers and the great power that there is in prayer. But that's not at the exclusion of the fact that we are to be godly in our... So if you've got a habitual sin, if you're living in a, like we just read here in Isaiah, the first prayer you want to pray is for God to forgive you and to help you to repent and to stop living that way and start living the right way. I mean, again, having been someone who has come from such a sordid background and where I was so engrossed in evil and had done so many horrific things, I know that at one point in my life, when I was good and deserving of it, when I deserved death and destruction, that the ever-loving arms of God reached out and helped me. I didn't get good and then God answered my prayers. I was a drunken heroin addict when God reached into my life and helped me. And it wasn't because I was good that He responded. But what did happen was there was a genuine desire to change and to repent. And when He responded to my prayer, then I embraced Him and went after Him. So I'm not trying to say that God doesn't help people who are sinners. If that was the case, none of us would be sitting here. But the thing is that you want to, if you want a powerful life like Jesus is describing, then you got to do it God's way. You got to live a holy life and a godly life, and then God will answer your prayers. And what a wonderful life it is. You know, we're not dependent upon ourselves. We don't have to seek wisdom for within. We have the wisdom of God right there at the street, right available and accessible to us. All we have to do is ask. And we're not talking about perfect, sinless living. The only one that did that left. And, you know, he's coming back, but, you know, I'm not talking about that either. Because there's times that we get caught in our sin. Obviously, we need help to get out of it, and we pray. I think you get the point. There's a balance to all of this. Let's go back to Matthew chapter 6. Jesus had a lot to say about prayer because it's vitally important. Matthew chapter 6, he was really again, this is the first teaching. It's the Sermon on the Mount. This is the introduction that Jesus gives to us about prayer. In Matthew chapter 6 and verse 5, he says, "When you pray, you are not to be like the hypocrites." Now he explains what a hypocrite is when it comes to praying. "For they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and on the street corners so that they may be seen by men. Truly I say to you, they have their reward in full. But you, when you pray, go into your inner room, close your door, and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you." The point is that these people were praying for the recognition of men. And he's saying, you don't do that. You pray, it's between you and God. Now, we had people pray here this morning in front of people. But these are mature believers that were praying to God and didn't really think about you, the other people that were in the room. I mean, we joined in with them, and they weren't praying so that they would get that a boy from you. They could care less about that. They were praying to God, and that's not the issue about being alone. It's where your heart is in relationship to your prayer. Is this so that other people think well of you, or are you doing it because you're really praying to the Father? You know, we're all tempted to have hypocrisy when it comes to the subject of prayer. Because when these people did pray this morning, you know, I think most of us, if not all of us, had our heads bowed. But some of us were thinking about something else other than the prayer. And that's kind of a hypocritical action, isn't it? We're acting like we're doing one thing and doing another thing. Hypocrisy is not just for these foreign people that are, you know, it's all of us have to face hypocrisy all the time. When we're praying together as a group, you want to engage your mind in what is being said so that you're not hypocritical in it. You know, you want to... We all fight this. You know, we got 1,000 thoughts in our heads. We're crazy people. We're turkeys, you know. That's our thing here. This is a part of living the right way, is fighting and disciplining yourself and learning and growing. Verse 7, "When you are praying, do not use meaningless repetition." I think the King James says vain repetition. That's what vain means. It's meaningless repetition, "as the Gentiles do, for they suppose that they will be heard for their many words. So do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask Him." Vain repetition or meaningless repetition is saying the same thing over and over again without thought as to what you're doing. The repetition is not the problem. As a matter of fact, we'll see in a few minutes here that Jesus encourages repetition. You want to pray, you want to stay consistent, and you want to be persistent, and so on. It's not repetition that's the problem. It's vain repetition that's the problem, or meaningless repetition. There are some that memorize prayers, and, you know, actually the prayer that he's about to tell here, the Lord's, it's called the Lord's Prayer by the Protestants. It's called the Our Father by the Catholics, and it's called the Disciples' Prayer by me. because I don't think it's a prayer. I don't think it's the Lord's prayer. I think it's a prayer that the Lord gave for his disciples to pray. I don't think the Lord prayed this prayer. You know why? Because it says, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Well, he didn't have that problem, did he? So at least that portion of the prayer he didn't pray. But the disciples need to pray this prayer. And that prayer has become for many a rote prayer, a mindless action. I'm just saying it without any thought, not thinking about it. What am I saying? That's not praying the proper way. That's vain repetition or meaningless robotic repetition. Repetition is good. I mean, there's a lot of prayers in the Word of God that we should pray that are very valuable, such as the prayer that Jesus gave to the disciples. Indeed, we should pray that, but not independent from your heart and your thinking. None of us like that. Who wants to have a conversation with somebody that their mind is elsewhere when they're talking to you? My wife has to fight that all the time with me, you know. So it's not, and she's not happy with that, you know. So nor is God when our minds and our hearts are not engaged. Again, this fundamental prayer stuff, verse 7, and when you are praying, do not use meaningless repetition. Verse 8, so do not be like them. I was taught that you just had to say the same prayers over and over again. I said them as fast as I could, never gave any thought to what I was saying. I prayed prayers like that thousands of times. And then, you know, then when I was exposed to the Bible and I sat down and someone said, what are you saying? Think about it. I was shocked at what I was saying. It just made no sense. Then I learned about the Lord's Prayer. That was one of the prayers I did. Now it is my guideline for prayer. Look at Luke 11. Luke 11. Verse 1. It happened that while Jesus was praying in a certain place, after he had finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. And I really love that. I love that the disciples, because you're one of Jesus' disciples, in my mind, that makes you a pretty good person. You know, you're moving in the right direction for sure. You're a good, you know, you're a disciple of Jesus. You're hanging around with Jesus. I like that they didn't know how to pray. Makes me feel not so stupid, turkeyish, you know. Lord, teach us to pray. And then he goes into this thing again with the prayer that is referred to as the Lord's Prayer. When you pray, say, Father, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, give us this day, forgive us our sins. And then verse 5, he said to them, suppose one of you has a friend and goes to him at midnight and says to him, friend, lend me 3 loaves. For a friend of mine has come to me from a journey, and I have nothing to set before him. And from inside he answers and says, do not bother me. The door has already been shut, and my children and I are in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything. I tell you that even though he will not get up and give him anything because he is his friend, yet because of his persistence or importunity, he will get up and give him as much as he needs. So I say to you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be open to you. This is not the same record. This is a different time. Now suppose one of you fathers is asked by his son for a fish. Will he give him a snake instead of a fish? Will he? Or will he ask for an egg and he will not give him a scorpion? Will he? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? I find encouragement in this is that Jesus repeats himself, and this is a whole different time. He says the same thing, but it's a whole different teaching, because I'm saying the same thing I've said before to some of you. This is a repeat for us. But we always need to be reminded about these fundamentals about prayer, the importance of prayer, And how to do it the right way. We always are needing the encouragement to keep on with this because it's such a vital part of our relationship with God and our walk with God. And that persistence, you know, the guy, I have company, but I don't have no food. So he goes to another friend and says, hey, could you give me a couple of loaves so I can feed my friend? He says, get out of here. I'm in bed. I ain't giving you no food. So, oh, come on, come on. And he kept on persisting. Just to get rid of the guy, he threw out some bread and the guy went home. At least this is my mind went with the story, you know. And it was through the persistence of asking for it over and over again. So I see repetition's not the problem. It's vain repetition that's the problem. And of course, in, you know, Luke 18, you know, this is that favorite record that really illustrates the importance of keeping on. Luke 18. Now he was telling them a parable to show that at all times they ought to pray and not to lose heart. They ought to keep on praying and not lose heart, saying, in a certain city there was a judge who did not fear God and did not respect man. He was a good judge, right? Didn't fear God and didn't respect man. There was a widow in that city, and she kept coming to him saying, give me legal protection from my opponent. For a while he was unwilling, but afterwards he said to himself, even though I do not fear God nor respect man, yet because this widow bothers me, this woman keeps on annoying me, I will give her legal protection, otherwise by continually coming she will wear me out. The Lord said, hear what the unrighteous judge said. Now will God bring about justice for his elect who cry to him day and night? And will he be delayed long over them? I tell you that he will bring about justice for them quickly. However, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? I wanted to end with this because I kind of feel this way, you know, as was prayed twice this morning. You know, this is a time when elections are going on in our country, and there's so much potential for injustice to be the end result of whatever happens, however it goes, and we all are confronted with the negativity of what's going on and how it can go. So what do? Well, we pray. We pray. And we have confidence in our God, and we persist in our prayer. It doesn't matter to us if it looks hopeless or it doesn't look like anything's going to work out. It doesn't matter. Actually, it should be an impetus for us to pray even much more, that our God would provide and that justice would prevail. To be like this woman that was so persistent with this guy that he eventually gave in. We need to pray for our country and pray for the people of our country to repent and to turn back to God and to accept God and for God's mercy to be upon our nation and upon us. But not only in that subject matter, everything is that we persist and God promises that he will provide. Closing, I'd like to set before you that there's three things there's many things, but three important parts of prayer that you want to always have a part of your daily routine is that, number one, prayers of thanksgiving and praise for God. Take time to just praise God and to thank God. Run through the things that God has done for you, is doing for you, has done for you. Thank God for just give God thanks. It's so important and to speak well of God. And then secondly, intercession. Intercession is where you're praying for other people. Good Lord, we all need your prayers. I mean, who do you know, who's in your life that doesn't need prayer? I mean, who do you know that doesn't need prayer? Everybody needs prayer. That's intercession where you ask God to bless the other people. The Lord's Prayer, by the way, is a prayer of intercession. It's an our, you know, give us this day. It's a plural where you're praying for other people, as is true of many of the prayers that are written in Scripture. So pray for each other and pray for me. I pray for you. We pray for each other. It's so important. Intercession. And then the last thing is petitions. Petitions are, actually, I think Lawrence in his prayer was referencing Philippians chapter 4. That you go read that this week. Philippians chapter 4 sets forth a great example of prayers of petition, where you're asking God for specific things. Instead of worrying, being full of anxiety and all the rest, you pray and you let the peace of God rule in your heart. And keep your mind on the things of God rather than the things of the world. So that you're praying for the things that you need instead of being worried about them and fearful and all uptight about them. I mean, God can provide for you. Just stay the course and be persistent.